صلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الأخلاء بعضهم يومئذ لبعض عدو إلا المتقين. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
Brothers, sisters, friends, assalamu alaikum jami'a wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. In our efforts to improve ourselves, to improve our communities, to achieve the most in this life and in the hereafter, if we want to win, win, rather than lose, lose, it's very difficult to lose and then win, or win and then lose. Usually you either win both or lose both. If you understand that when times are difficult here, you're being rewarded and you're doing well in your exam. If you're under exam conditions and you're doing well, you don't really get too bothered, do you? You still, although you are under pressure, you feel happy because you think, this is a good exam, I know the answers, I'm very busy writing, very busy answering, but it's good, it's something I can deal with. But we, my brothers, sisters, we are humans and we are heavily influenced by the environment we live in. We are all unique and independent, but we are remarkably dependent, affected by the environment in which we live. And sometimes we don't actually realize how strong that influence is, but we are influenced by our environment. Environments include families, the families that we're born into, their choices, their decisions. By the time we are adults, by the time we make our own decisions, we are affected in so much in our lives by what our parents have decided, by what they have done, by the choice of the location they live in, by the choice of the knowledge they give to us, and by so many other factors. It's their choices. This has got nothing to do with us, it's just them. And we're affected by the friends we choose, or at least, and I'll talk about this today inshallah, the friends we choose. Choose is in capital, underlined, italics, bold, whatever you want. Needs to be really clear. We don't seem to choose our friends, my brothers, my sisters. We seem to fall into friendships. We seem to happen, you go to school one day, you happen to share a seat with somebody, somebody sitting next to you. You share a class with them, they become your friends. And then your friends, and that's it. It's accidental. Yet, while we can't choose our families, these are the friends, these are the people. If we choose correctly, we can improve ourselves. If we choose wrongly, we could really cause ourselves a lot of damage. Sometimes we realize, sometimes we don't. Let me tell you a bit about a scientific experiment. It's interesting. it's really interesting. In an American university, they were trying to investigate the influence of peer pressure. How does the decisions, the choices of the people around you affect you? Okay? That was the aim of the study. But they didn't tell the participants that, because that would cause bias in the study. They just never told them, just told them, come in. We're trying to study your ability to look at objects and turn them 3D in the kind of imagine them rotated. As an example, if you have an object, say, I don't know, a box, they say, imagine it turned this way, what does it look like? And they give you 5 choices or whatever, and you tick the right answer. So you look at the item, you imagine it rotated in your head, and then you tick the right answer. Simple. The first part of the study, they took participants, whatever, let's say 20. They took the participants, they sat them in a room, gave them sheets of paper individually, told them to be quiet, silently, showed them the object, told them to imagine it, tick one of the answers, showed them the next object, and so on, so forth. So they all decided based on their own individual assessments. People typically scored between 70 and 90% correctly. So they could look at it, imagine it turned, choose. Then, the second part of the study, they brought people into the room, asked them to answer loudly. So they came to the first person and said, what do you think? The first person gave the answer, then the second, then the third, then the fourth. They all gave the answers out loud. Okay? But there was a twist. The first 19 people were told, they were in on the study. They told them, give the wrong answer, and they told them which wrong answer to give. So the first one said, let's say the right answer is C, the first one said B, the second said B, the third said B, the fourth said B, and so on. 19 of them. The last one didn't know anything, he thought it was all innocent. What the study found is that this same person who scored 90% privately is now only scoring 10%. Instead of, he knows the answer, he has the ability to imagine the object turned in the space, and he will get it right 90% of the time. But when he heard 19 people say something different, he or she gave the wrong answer anyway. And then they took this person, brought in another person from the other volunteers, exactly the same thing. Third, exactly the same thing. Fourth, exactly the same thing. The end of the study, those who scored between 70 and 90% correctly when they were tested privately, answered between 10 and 30% correctly when they saw 19 other people give the wrong answer. And they didn't know. It's not like they knew these people were giving the wrong answers. They just sat there thinking it's all innocent. What this shows is when there is an environment and when everybody seems to do something, something happens to you. And when these candidates were interviewed in this study afterwards, 2 reasons were identified. One, some of them said, I knew I was right. I was so confident with my answer, but I didn't want to stand out. I didn't want to be the one person out of 20 people to say, after so many people give the wrong answer, give a certain answer, for me to say, I disagree with all of you, you're all wrong, and I'm right. I just didn't want to be the person that stands out. But here is the dangerous part. Others said, genuinely thought, if so many people do it differently, I must be wrong. And genuinely, their judgment was clouded. They couldn't see right and wrong once they were in the group, but they could when they were on their own. What's the take-home message? Message is, if you want to make right answers, put yourself in a group that's likely to make right answers. If you want to make wrong answers, surround yourself by people that will make the wrong answer. Simple as that. And they will both affect your courage and judgment. Sometimes you'll know you're doing the wrong thing and you do it anyway, and sometimes you don't even know it. Sometimes it just becomes so natural for you to follow the group, and you still think you're independent, just like these people in the study thought they were independent. And I said, while we can't choose our families, we can choose our friends. It's not good enough, my brothers, my sisters, it's not good enough to choose a friend because your parents, some years ago, decided to live in a certain area. So you happened to attend the same school, and you happened to have been born in the same year, or plus or minus a year or two. You ended up in the same locality, you happened to bump into each other, and now you're friends. This is a very bad way of choosing friends. We can do better. We can do better by vetting these people that we choose to bring close to ourselves, because we know, whether we know it or not, they will make us who we are. They will change us. Imam Ali alayhi salam says, don't ask about a person if you want to know them. Ask about their friends. Their choice of friends, their choice of the people they want to be with is much more revealing about their personality, the real them, than what they choose to show you. Because, you know, we all have guards and barriers. With our friends, we're comfortable. We let the guards down. Because we let the guards down, these are the people we are influenced by and we influence. This is the environment that is reflective of who we really are. And so if these friends that you and I choose, if you think there is something wrong with them, if you find them embarrassing to present to the community or to bring to this place or to show them to your parents, why have them? If we know that our choices will affect us, then rather than following the crowd, we can make that stand early on. It's not a friend, my brothers, my sisters, someone who doesn't care about us. Visibly they might care about us, but if somebody is leading us the wrong way and sending us to hell, that's not somebody who cares. If it's somebody who's offering us drugs and destroying our life because probably they want to make some money, or they're naive, it's one of them. Either they're just naive themselves, or they really want to get us hooked so they can abuse us physically, financially, otherwise. This is not a friend. This is an opportunity. This is somebody who wants to abuse our trust and abuse our naivety. And for some reason, we, as human beings, we are social beings, and we let our guards down to people that are similar to us. Same age, same experience, same background. We tend to let them in. And there's nothing wrong with that. That's actually a great thing. But while you have your mind, while you can make the decision, let those that you can trust in. Invite them in if you can trust them, and then let them influence you. That's a good thing. Choose good people and let them influence you. Remember, if these people, if you had the wrong answer in that study that we mentioned earlier, and every person in the 20 before you loudly said the right answer, even if you had the wrong answer, chances are you'll change it and say the right answer anyway. So the influence can be both positive and negative. Instead of letting our friends bring us down, we should let them bring us up. Let this be a positive spiral. And we can all choose. We really can all choose. It might be very difficult. We join a new school or a new university. We just want friends. There is nobody to talk to. And the first person that gives us some attention, we open to them. And then suddenly we are part of their circle. But that's not the best way of doing it. Let's have some confidence. And let us go to the right environment where we can meet such friends, such people. Such as this place. Take part in community work. And there will be many great people in the community that are similar to you, similar interests, similar backgrounds, but whose presence is positive in your life. It's possible to do that. Choose that. The verse that I started with says al-akhilla'u ba'dhum yawma'idhin li-ba'dhin 'aduwwun illa al-muttaqin. The verse talks about friends on the Day of Judgment. So the verse says, on the Day of Judgment, friends are enemies to each other on the Day of Judgment. Friends are enemies apart from those who believed, al-muttaqeen. Taqwa is the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the broadest sense. It's implementation, following, and fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not the negative fear, it's the positive fear that leads to behavioral change and the right decisions made. Now why? Why are the enemies generally apart from these people? Because of this. If you've chosen the wrong crowd on the Day of Judgment, you go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and say, it wasn't my fault, he influenced me, she influenced me. It's not me, it's them. You blame them. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks them, they say, you followed, I never forced you. You chose to be with me. Or, it's your fault, you influenced me as well. It becomes a blame game. It's you, it's you, it's you, it's you. But those who feared Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment have all done good to each other. So on the Day of Judgment, they're still friends because simply, they kind of almost want to thank each other for the good things they've done for each other. There's nothing for them to blame each other about. Because they had fear for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here, and they both belong to the same positive circle, and they helped each other out. And so instead of choosing enemies for ourselves on the Day of Judgment, we should choose friends for ourselves on the Day of Judgment. And even the greatest, obviously the Prophet, the Imams, they're infallible. They would be able, by definition, to be on the right path regardless of what circle of people around them. But they taught us. Their action, their teachers, right? One of the main functions of prophets, of messengers, is to teach. So they behave in a certain way for us to learn from them. They lead by example, they show us. And that's the function of the prophet. So that if we, my brothers, my sisters, 1400 years after the prophet, if we face a similar problem to his, we have a method that we can follow. We know how to deal with it. We have a teacher who's showed us how to deal with these things. That's why Ahlul Bayt struggled so much, and almost every problem you face in your life, there's a reference to their lives. They've demonstrated a way of dealing with it. Including this. Imam Ali alayhi salam also says, I quoted him earlier and I'll quote him again, he says a good friend is one who protects you in three situations. At times of your difficulty, by protect he means they will think of you, they will do the right thing towards you regardless. Three things. When you're in difficulty, when you're absent, when you're dead. This is interesting. When you're in difficulty, usually, sometimes, if you're when things are good, some people will be with you because they want to take some of that good from you. You're a good, whether you're rich or whether you have social status or whatever. When things are bad, generally, that's the first filtration process. Some people will disappear. Things are good, they're with you. Things are bad, they disappear. But they're not friends. Don't even be sad that they disappeared. Be happy you got rid of them. They're not people, they're not even worth your time. Further, somebody who will take care of you in your absence. It's not like you're watching them. It's not like you are there, so they're trying to show you a certain behavior. You're not even there, you're away. You're somewhere else. But their behavior towards your property, towards your family, towards what people say about you, in your absence. So they're not showing you. So one thing is how they behave when you're present, but how do they behave when you're not there? Second. Third, when you're dead, see, if you're absent, you might come back and still hear from the environment, from the community, what they've done in your absence. When you're dead, there is no hope for you to return. They don't think you're going to punish them or have a go at them or discuss with them what they've said about you in their absence. They're dead. But they still are faithful. They're still good friends. They're still people who care. These are the truest of friends. These are the people that deserve to occupy our time. Apply this test to your friends. Say, what would this person do when I'm not funny anymore, or interesting anymore, or not very clever at school anymore? What would they do if I go away? What would they do even if I'm gone completely, if I'm dead? How would they treat me? How would they treat my memory? How would they treat my family? If somebody can pass this test, they are a good friend. Imam Ali alayhi salam had people in his life that fulfilled this criteria. You might think, you know, when you start to think about it, you think, how difficult. This is not an easy task. Finding true friends is not an easy task. But you don't need many, you might need just one. One good friend. Actually, no friends is much better than bad friends. But one good friend can do wonders to your life. And there are many, plenty good people. There are good people. You just need to find them. And Imam Ali, for example, had one of his commanders called Malik al-Ashtar. Malik al-Ashtar was somebody, he was somebody. Brave, very brave, very respected, a senior commander. Even the Prophet appointed him for some of the battles as a commander. He was a somebody, a command, kind of a usual commander for Imam Ali alayhi salam. Generous, very knowledgeable. And the way he behaved, as many people observed, when the Imam is present, when the Imam is absent, is exactly the same. He was faithful in every moment. He put himself in danger because he believed in what the Imam was telling him. And that's a difficult decision, my friends. It's very easy to behave normally in day to day. It's just when you're tested, when you're pressured, that's when true colors are revealed. And Malik was one of those. And the Prophet, he took care of some of his companions, he nurtured them, he spoke to them, he had lots of companions, but there were a bunch of them that he brought very close to him because they deserved that proximity. And we must, if we want to learn from these examples, we must, like I said, if the decisions made by your friends, if the things they invite you to do, if the things they encourage you to do, if their appearance next to you, if they're good, you should be happy to bring them anywhere and everywhere. You should be happy to introduce them to your parents, to bring them to your own house, to bring them to the community, introduce them to the rest of your friends and family. If you don't, ask yourself why. What is so wrong with this person? Why do I not want people to see them? Why do I not want people to know everything about them? And if we get this right, get the method right, they will help us improve without us having to put in much effort. It'll be enjoyable. Being with friends would be something good. In fact, if you do this with the intention of getting nearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being with your friends will be rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You will get thawab and fun with your friends. Being with them would be thawab. And obviously vice versa. And Imam al-Hussein, on a night like this, people usually talk about the companions of Imam al-Hussein. You might have heard some before. I'll remind you of some of the stories of how these people came about. Who they were. If you have a friend that, when things are so difficult for you, would they put themselves in trouble to protect you? Let's all ask ourselves this question. It's a private question. You can think about it tonight. Seriously, just review them one by one. If things are really bad for you, if there is a threat to your welfare, would they put themselves in danger for you? Or would they, at that moment of pressure, give up? If you have one of these people that are prepared to put themselves in danger for you, you're very lucky. Imam al-Hussein had at least 72 people. 72 people who have been tested and passed. There were many others who weren't tested as much. These people were tested and they have proven themselves on the day. First, it shows his ability to choose, his ability to filter the good from the bad, from the community. It was a community. It wasn't a better community than we are now. No, it was community. It had good people, bad people, had everyone. But he chose from them. He filtered them. But also, how close would you be to such friends? How important would they be in your heart? Those who are prepared to put themselves in difficulty and danger for you. How special would they be? And how painful would it be for you to see them suffer? How painful would it be for you to watch them struggle for your cause, for your decision, for your judgment? And this is an added suffering that the Imam had to go through on that day. In addition to him and his family's loss, he had to watch these friends go, to watch their loss and feel it. Al-Imam Hussein, on his way from Mecca, he had lots of people, there were large crowds around him. When the news from Kufa that I told you about yesterday happened, unfolded, when Muslim was killed, he told people the truth. He told them, this is what happened. Those who want to go are free to go. And many of them went. There were many people that disappeared. But the people that left Medina with him, and some that joined Mecca, stayed with him. The same people that he chose stuck with him. And then he made it to Karbala. He had some companions. Kufa was under siege after Muslim, completely under siege. Nobody is allowed to ride a horse. If you walk with your horse to the borders of the city, you get arrested. It means you're making a long journey. In other words, these days, if you drive to the borders of the city, you get arrested. What Habib ibn Mudahir and Muslim did, they sent their horses with other people. And horses were important, people would recognize them. And they were leaders. And so when the guards asked them, what are you doing with the horse? They were saying, well, I'm just giving them some water, just taking them for a walk and giving them water. This is somebody else, one of your servants would do this. Then Habib would walk. Where are you going, Habib? Oh, I'm just walking. Then he goes one route, the horse goes the other route. He picks his horse later and then heads to Karbala. That's the amount of effort they put to be with Imam Hussein. That's how they tricked the system. That's why only a few of them managed to escape the siege, including Habib ibn Mudahir. Zuhair ibn al-Qayn. Zuhair wasn't a lover of Ahlul Bayt before. He wasn't one of the people that lived with Ahlul Bayt. He didn't quite understand everything. On the way, he happened to be going from Mecca to Kufa, to Iraq, heading that way, and Imam was heading. And he didn't like the Imam so much, and some of his friends that were with him didn't like the Imam so much, they wanted to avoid being in the same place as the Imam. Until one location they had to, there was no alternative, they happened to stay. The journey was long. They went on kind of horseback or walked. It was a long journey, so they had to rest. And there were resting points. In one of these resting points, they met. Imam sent his messenger to Zuhair. Come, I want to talk to you. Zuhair thought, I've been trying to avoid this all the journey. This is what I've been trying to avoid the whole journey, and now this guy comes. Do I go? Do I not go? Zuhair had a good wife. His wife said, how strange. The grandson of the Prophet wants to talk to you. Go and listen to his message, see what he's got to say, and then come back. Just go. What's wrong with you? He thought, okay, that's a good point. He headed towards Imam Hussein. Soon he returned, happy. He came to his wife and said, you saved my life, thank you. But I'm heading with Imam. And the Imam says, we're going to be killed. And you should go home, go to your family. In those goodbye moments, Zuhair cried, his wife cried. She told him, Zuhair, on the day of judgment, don't forget me when you see the grandfather of Hussein. It was me who encouraged you to go and talk to him. So when people asked him, what happened, Zuhair, he said, on one battle many years ago, we won so much, there was so much to be taken in that battle. We won, the battle. We got so much of a reward, financial reward. And Salman al-Muhammadi, one of the companions of the Prophet, said, if you live to the day when the grandson of the Prophet is to be supported and you support him, you should be much happier than this reward, to be with him. That would be... And Imam reminded me of this day, and now I realized, and he explained to me, and I'm going with him. That's it. And Zuhair was one of the commanders of the Imam on the day of Ashura. On the day as the battle unfolded, before the battle started, one of the people that brought Al-Imam al-Husayn to that location in Karbala was Al-Hur al-Riyahi. Al-Hur was a commander, and he never thought it would end that way. He never thought the battle would end so badly. He thought there would be no battle, they will resolve it, and problem will be solved. And so on that day, while he's standing there, one of his friends sees him shivering, trembling, shaking. He says, Hur, if I was to be asked who's the bravest man in Kufa, I would have never chosen anyone else. I would have chosen you. Why are you so scared? He says, I'm choosing between heaven and hell. This is the time to choose between heaven and hell, and I'll never choose anything except heaven. He walks to Imam al-Husayn on his horseback, slowly, his head down. He gets to the Imam and says, Imam, do you remember the one who brought you here? Do you remember the man who scared your family? Do you remember the man that stopped you from reaching your destination? It was me. And I've been thinking now, and I'm full of regret and repentance. Do I have a chance? Is it too late? Imam says, no, it's never too late. Come down, Hur. He says, I don't want to come down. I'm much more useful for this battle if I'm on my horse. I don't want to come down. I was the first one to bring you here. I want to be the first one to go and get killed. And then Hur heads to the battlefield. Hur fights them bravely. Hur fights his own soldiers that he was commanding. Hur fights and fights. He falls to the ground. Hur is wounded. Hur is in pain. Hur is bleeding. Hur is about to die, and Imam al-Husayn comes to him, wipes his forehead, says, you are a free man, just like your mother named you. Hur dies in those moments. He's one of those companions. Habib ibn Madahir, when the Imam al-Husayn told them to send their wives back because his family is going to be taken as prisoners of war, his wife refused to go, said, Hur, it's not fair. You go and get killed with Husayn. And I end up going to my family. I want to be with Zainab. You go with Husayn, I go with Zainab. You do your bit, I'll do my bit. And Habib was one of the companions of the Prophet. He had such a special position in the mind of the Imam. He had such a special position in the army. So when Habib went to battle, just before Habib goes to battle, Muslim went to battle and was killed. Muslim was about to die, and Habib and Imam Husayn walked to him. Habib says, Muslim, congratulations on reaching heaven. Muslim weakly says, thank you. Habib says, I know I'm dying after you, otherwise I'd have asked you, what would you want me to do for you? Muslim says, points towards the Imam and says, support this man. That's the only thing I want you to do. And then Habib does. Habib goes to the battle, fights them very bravely. Habib is killed. The Imam walks to Habib. Imam is standing next to Habib. Imam says that his army is weakened by the loss of Habib. And afterwards, when Imam Husayn is on his own, he calls them by name. Zuhair. Wala Zuhair Ali al-Yom. Habib. Wala Habib Ali al-Yom. And he calls them one by one because there were such true friends, such true companions that stood firm when it counted. And that's why they deserve to be remembered. My brothers, my sisters, let us choose wisely when it comes to friends, and let us pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at the end to guide us in our choices, to give us the strength, and to give us the wisdom to understand and to take the steps necessary to make our lives better, both this world and the hereafter. Let us pray that may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hasten the reappearance of our Imam. Allahumma ajil farajah wa sahil makhrajah. Ja'alna min ansarihi wa a'wanih. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين.
اللهم صل على محمد.